Want to know what your dad tore up the streets in? Probably one of these. The Chevrolet 409. Coming up next on the American Muscle Car. You're looking at the Impala Supersport. Chevrolet made over 2 million Impalas between 1961 and 1965, making this one of the most beloved and popular cars of the muscle era. But it's not the cars people remember, it's their engines. These cars happen to be powered by a legendary muscle motor, the mighty 409. The Chevrolet 409 was born in 1961 in the heat of the horsepower wars, when Chevrolet was into racing up to its hubcaps. It grew from a run-of-the-mill truck engine to become one of the most feared and respected power plants of its day. The 409 had enough horsepower to propel 4,000-pound Impalas and Bel Airs to wins at every racetrack and drag strip in America. And its tire-burning torque gave the Super Sport Chevys the image of the baddest boulevard cruisers in the land.
One of the big reasons that the 409 has become such a legend, I believe, is because Chevrolet promoted it as such, as a performance engine from day one.
That's really, I think, what brought attention to it. And then from the 409, they went into the 396s, the 427s, but really it was probably Chevy's first step into a real big racing engine.
During the 5 years that Chevrolet built the 409, it grew from 340 to 425 horsepower, and it was offered in several different versions, from slightly wild to really wild. 409s never came in mild versions. The 409 helped create the Super Sport mystique, and today the SS nameplate is one of the most successful in the auto industry. Chevy sold hundreds of thousands of Super Sport Novas and Chevelles with small block engines on the strength of the 409 Impala's drag strip reputation.
It was the first Chevrolet big block, which has got a lot going for it right there. It had a lot of torque with 2 4-barrel carburetors. It would do 0 to 60 in about 4.5 seconds. It would do the quarter mile in about 12.2 at roughly 115. Now, this is a prepared car.
Today, the full-size Chevrolets of that era are fabulous examples of the American muscle car during its big period. Like the other big, fast cars of the day, the Ford Galaxy, the Pontiac Grand Prix, the Mercury Montclair, and the Chrysler 300, the Impala reminds us of an era when the muscle car was the biggest, the most luxurious, and the most powerful car on the road. When you drove up in one of these cars, you knew you had arrived.
I graduated in 64 from high school in Sydney, New York, and back then, if I had had a car like this, I would have been king of the road.
Back in a minute, as America falls in love with racing Big Detroit Iron on the American Muscle Car. This is what the muscle car looked like before 1955. They called them hot rods. They weren't built by any automobile company. They were built by people who wanted a car that was distinctive and faster than most of the factory models. This art form was wide open to individual expression. Pretty soon, Detroit started noticing all these home builds on the street, and they noticed the enthusiasm for auto racing that was sweeping the country. Soon, the big automakers began testing the waters with a few special edition cars, which featured lots of horsepower. These special edition cars sold by the truckload, which encouraged Detroit to build even bigger and faster ones. The horsepower race was on, with some pretty wild cars showing up on the streets all over America. These were the first factory hot rods, or, if you prefer, the first factory muscle cars. Detroit also used the best R&D proving grounds ever created, America's racetracks. Racing was good for testing high-performance parts and great for selling cars. Chevrolet had jumped into this performance race in 1955 with their 265-cubic-inch small-block V8. Over the next 3 years, Chevy's small blocks grew to 283 cubic inches and had enough horsepower to propel their classic lightweight Bel Airs into the winner's circle all over America. But cars were getting bigger and heavier every year, and the engine designers had to keep making more horsepower. Ford's new 312 Y-Block in their 1957 Fairlane sported a supercharger. Chrysler had 2 4-barrel carburetors feeding their big engine. At Pontiac, they were building the trophy-class Bonnevilles into world beaters. Pontiac even tested their engines under some incredible loads, like open parachutes. Chevrolet's engine lab was working 24 hours a day, squeezing more power from the small block. With trick setups like fuel injection, the 283 was creating ample horsepower to keep the Chevys in the lead. But without all this exotic equipment, which was banned from stock car racing in 1958, the 283 just wasn't big enough to outrace the new larger Fords and Chryslers, especially in the new heavier Impalas, which now weighed almost 2 tons. Chevy did have another engine available, however, the rather unglamorous 348 cubic inch V8. This was a working class motor designed for light trucks and never really intended as a high revving race engine. However, it was sturdy, it produced nice torque, and it could be modified fairly easily. Most importantly, there was enough beef in the cylinder block to bore this engine out to unheard of displacements. With the 348, Chevy enjoyed modest success on the drag strips and managed to win the NASCAR Grand National Championship in 1960. On the racetrack, Chevy discovered just how far they could go with the 348, and it wasn't far enough. So in 1961, in classic Detroit fashion, they made it bigger. The 348 block was bored out to 409 cubic inches, and a legend was born. The 409 engine was created by using a 4.313-inch bore and a stroke of 3.5. The 61 409 produced 360 horsepower at 4,200 RPM from what was basically just an enlarged 348 with a slightly hotter camshaft and a bigger Rochester 4-barrel carburetor.
The 409 engine was unique in that it had no combustion chamber in the cylinder head, as was the convention in the industry. If you pull a 409 cylinder head off, it's flat. Looks like a tractor cylinder head. That did affect the its breathability. It didn't respond to cam changes the way a normal engine would.
The 61 409s had been rushed into production using bored out 348 blocks right off the shelf. Chevy found out that these blocks couldn't stand the extreme stresses of racing duty. Production was halted after just 147 units were built, and Chevy's engine designers went back to the lab. When the 409 returned to the racetrack in 1962, it was race ready. Stay with us as the American muscle car continues.